I was the officer in charge of the Blue Escort Group. That's what the official name was, and we were meant to be escorting Springboks to and from training, games and at accommodation.
But it turned out to be so much more than that, right?
Well, yes, certainly. That was just pushed to one side, still included in our duties, but we became, by default, a quasi-ride squad. Certainly at Hamilton, that was a real turning point, and it was after that game it was time to reflect and see, well, what we do next.
You were at Hamilton. What was that like?
I can remember that we had six police officers dressed up in track suits with rugby boots to tackle anyone who came through the fence. Well, I tackled six, but another few hundred came through, so that didn't work out too well. But then they grouped in the middle, and from there on, I think the rest is history. But we have to remember that while this was going on, a chap of the name of Macquarie had stolen an aeroplane, and we knew from intelligence that he was going to, well, he was threatened that he would crash the plane into the grandstandville. So that was very significant in the calling off the game.
How did you re-strategise after Hamilton?
They just cranked everything up to bigger numbers. And I think after Hamilton, we came here to Taranaki. There weren't many demonstrators there. Those brave people that were there, they marched. And then after that, I think we went to Palmerston North, and that's where the barbed wire suddenly appeared overnight, put up by army engineers, and people were thinking, well, this is getting quite serious.
Can you tell us about the sort of the riot gear that you were wearing?
I think some of the demonstrators were better equipped than we were with their motorcycle crash helmets, and some were wearing buoyancy jackets and things, but we just had a composite plastic helmet with a visor that you could lift up or down, and shin pads, robust boots, and PR24.
And what was so unique about the PR24?
Well, that was quite new to New Zealand policing, but the PR24 is of American origin, but it's purely a defensive or offensive baton. And the main thing it was used for prodding. It wasn't swung around or anything like a baseball bat. And it just got people moving.
People say that the police used excessive force. What do you say to that?
Well, what you say to that is that...
Did you?
No. What happens is that you can protest peacefully, and then when it gets ratcheted up, you're told you can't go past this line, and if you go past that line, then you'll be stopped going past it. And another thing there was, during the tour, there were police photographers filming everything that was happening, so...
So you stand by, you think the police were appropriate in their use of force?
Yes. And you mentioned about ratcheting up, things ratcheting up, and so was the desire to disrupt all the games were ratcheting up, and we were just the thin blue line, getting a bit frayed in places, but that's between anarchy and peacefulness, isn't it?
How stretched did that thin blue line get?
Well, it got very stretched, especially during the third test in Auckland, in Marlborough Street there. They nearly overran us there and would have just trickled into Cricket Avenue and onto the field, yeah.
That was a particularly fiery day, and some of the protesters felt that the police were having one last go at them.
No, they were the ones having one last go, that's for sure. And a very concerted one last go, yes.
Has this 81 tour left any blemishes on the police?
I think it left blemishes on everyone, to be fair. It wasn't just a game of rugby, it wasn't just sport, there were huge political repercussions worldwide about it. And I think everyone went up a notch as far as growing up a bit as to the effect of a situation and a terrible event.
What overall impact do you think the tour had on the culture of the police?
Once it was finished, we all thought we've got to move on. Just leave it all behind.
Was there any trauma, do you think, that police suffered?
Well, yes, certainly did. I remember one of my staff really got to him, yeah. I won't go any more into that, but it, yeah, certainly did.
What sort of injuries did police suffer?
I know one of my staff lost the top of a finger in Marlborough Street during the third test. There were other knocks, the odd stitches here and there.
The extent of injuries were pretty bad, and someone, I think John Minto said, had it gone on one more week, there would have been deaths.
I would incline to agree with him too. It was just getting worse and worse. You could just feel it and sense it, that something bad was going to happen.
Are you proud of leading the Blue squad?
Of course I was. They did a magnificent job. Well, they were given a task. They did it without any whinging or moaning and just got on with it. There are always critics, but I certainly stand up for them.